Thank you. So you are here on the room. And don't forget, this is a non-smoking flight. The emergency exits are located there, there. And in case of a coffee or water emergency, we also have your backs. If I can ask you to join me today for the Cyber Circus, and I think you'll enjoy the show more if you come into the center aisles. In fact, let's make this interesting here at the Cyber Circus. I got $2 saying none of you are gonna come in to the front or to the aisles. Anyone wanna prove me wrong? You proving me wrong right there? Okay, these $2 are yours. You got it, nice. Okay, let's up the stakes for those people still not convinced. One more thing, I'll have an autographed book by me and this lady right here in the front row for at least one of the next few people that join us here in the middle. And isn't it fun, guys? Don't you need some exercise during RSA conference? Or just to prove that security professionals will do things for swag? All right, thank you. Yes, thank you. Thank you so much for proving me right. All right, how's it feeling back there in the cheap seats? Can you see anything? You good? You're happy there? Okay, I might have to come down there and drag you down here. Okay, good. So, emergency exits are there, but the show's up in here. Screens to the right and to the left of me. My name is Keren Elazari, and I am from Israel, so I will have an Israeli accent featured throughout this presentation. If for some reason some of the things I say are not so clear, I'll try and, you know, make it extra legible for you, because I really want you guys to know what I have to say. I'm known online as Keren E. All of the E's are spelled with the number 3, K3, R3, N3. Catchy, right? And what we're gonna talk about today, as you're joining me in the circus show, is a few very interesting things. We'll have, like any circus, we'll have tightrope, death-defying balancing acts, we'll have fearless lion taming, and of course, no circus is complete without elephants. But here are a few elephants that will not be joining us. So, a few elephants in the room that we're not gonna be discussing today. These gentlemen and lady will not be featured in today's presentation, although I see it as a very popular topic this year at RSA, and I can understand why. No, these are not the topics that we have in mind. In fact, what I'd like to talk to you today is what the future of cybersecurity will look like when everything and anything can be hacked, when our printers can be hacked by Mr. Robot, who's interrupting my presentation, and when we're walking down the expo halls at RSA and all of the vendors are telling us that if we don't secure our, perhaps, badges or our printers or our phones, then the world's gonna end. Indeed, it seems like end times are near. So what is the Cyber Circus and why you should care about it? These are the things that I hope you walk away with from today's presentation. And I'd like to give you some hope instead of the fear that is very popular these days in our industry. Sound good? You guys ready to roll? You got safety belts, emergency exits, everything's covered? All right, anybody wanna switch seats? Now's the time. No? We're heading to the runway. Let's go. We don't have a lot of time today, but I have a few very important things that I want to share with you. And it does seem like every day we're hearing about a new type of attack. Just this morning, I heard that a ransomware proof of concept malware, so that's a type of virus that locks out the data, that encrypts the data on devices, a proof of concept form of ransomware has been discovered for PLCs. Those are programmable logic controllers. Those are the same things that were hacked back in 2010 during the Stuxnet virus. So if a proof of concept type of ransomware for devices like that is already out there, we really don't have a lot of time. I do hope the lights stay up for this presentation, though. Here's my point of view about the Cyber Circus. It really isn't about any secrets anymore. In fact, many of us don't have a lot of things to hide. Not from the Big Brother, not from Facebook, not from Google, that's for sure. So I think the future of cybersecurity is going to be about protecting the trust that we place in our way of life. And with everyday news headlines about hacking everything and anything, how can people trust technology? Think about you here in the room, you are security professionals. The people back home, how do they see these headlines every day? How afraid are they to log on to a wireless network or to use their phone or to buy a new device? Or perhaps we are already at a point where the Cyber Circus is so dazzling and it's present everywhere, they're just, okay, I'm gonna give up. I'm either gonna join the Amish or I'm just gonna trust that everything's gonna be fine and pray and hope. But that's not gonna help us. So because I don't think we don't have a lot of secrets anymore, I'll share a little secret with you about me. I grew up as a child in Tel Aviv, and I was very curious and I was very fascinated with secrets. And I always wanted to know how things worked. And I'd crawl under the table to unplug cables and push buttons and see what happened. And I spent a lot of time in reading books and in the lab. And here's another secret, that's not what I looked like. I was an aspiring hacker, but that's also not what I looked like. So before the next slide, I just need to ask the audience a quick question. Who here in the room has already seen me talk somewhere or heard my talks in a few places? Okay, so I have a few fresh jokes for you guys, but I'll be able to recycle my jokes for the rest of the presentation. That's good to know. So here's the truth that the people who know me know about me. This is what I looked like when I was an aspiring young hacker. It's a real photo from my elementary school in Tel Aviv. It will be a little bit difficult for you guys to find me in this picture, because that's me. So that's the brutal truth. I was the nerdy girl who looked like a boy and would not even part ways with her Sony Walkman for the yearly photo. And I didn't have a lot of friends. In fact, even the guys playing Dungeons and Dragons wouldn't let me join their team. But I had a legend to follow. I had an icon. I had an inspiration. And I think you might be able to recognize her because her name is Angelina Jolie. Although this picture was also taken 20 years ago, this is when she portrayed Acid Burn, the fierce young hacker in the film Hackers that came out in 95. When I saw this movie, I realized that hackers can do anything. They can control the traffic light systems and change IRS records, and they can rollerblade, and they can be Angelina Jolie. So that's what I wanted to be too. And I decided to become a hacker, and as I saw it in the movie, I saw hackers as the heroes. I saw them as the good guys saving the day. A bunch of high school kids outsmarting everybody, including the FBI, and showing everyone what's what. So that's what I wanted to be. I think I did pretty well. In the past 20 years, I've worked with a few companies and organizations that perhaps you've heard about. And in the past 5 years, as an academic researcher and a teaching fellow at both Singularity University here in California and Tel Aviv University's Cyber Center in Israel. So that's who I am, and that's my background. That's the secrets that make up my puzzle. But perhaps you're here because I'm more well-known for this not-so-secret talk I gave a couple years ago at a little conference called TED. My idea for the TED stage was that hackers can actually save the day, that hackers can be the immune system for our connected age. And here's the crazy thing. Almost 2 million people felt the same way. So now I wake up every morning and I get messages from hackers from around the world, literally from West Africa and Canada and South Korea. And what they're saying is, yes, we want to help. And we keep demonstrating things and we keep talking to people, but everybody thinks we're the bad guys. How can we change the world? How can we make a difference? So I have a few ideas about that for you guys as well. An immune system, why would we even need one? Well, I was first inspired to think about hackers as the immune system because of this guy, Barnaby Jack. In fact, it was right here at RSA conference a few years ago that Barnaby first demonstrated and showed to a live audience how he is able to remotely hack an embedded insulin pump. That's a device that changes and improves lives for diabetic patients around the world. It also runs on a microcomputer and can be accessible with a radio signal. Barnaby discovered that with the right signal, he could actually trigger the pump to dump any of the remaining insulin into a patient's bloodstream. Of course, that sounds dangerous, if not lethal, but he never hurt anyone. He conducted this presentation safely. And a lot of people were very scared with what he did, and some people might have thought it would be reckless, but I thought he actually triggered an important change right here in the United States and around the world with how people see the medical devices that they trust their lives with every day. In fact, it was after his demos and a few papers and demonstrations by other hackers that the Federal Accountability Office here in the US and the FDA issued this very first warning to medical device companies to start taking into consideration cybersecurity of medical devices. And that was a few years ago, and we've definitely moved ages ahead, and there's a lot of interesting things happening. Barnaby said that sometimes it's up to hackers to demonstrate a threat so that we can spark a solution. And that really stuck with me, demonstrate a threat to spark a solution. But some of the hacking that we're seeing every day, some of the things, the talks that we're hearing even here at RSA or DEF CON and other security conferences are usually just that. They're demos. Like 2 weeks ago, I saw a professor take down a drone with an acoustic attack using sound waves. That's pretty awesome. That's science fiction stuff. It's also pretty scary. And definitely hackers and security researchers are demoing the threat. But are we sparking the solution? These are one of the questions that I hope to answer with you guys here today. As more and more medical devices are coming into the market, of course, more security researchers are interested in them. Meet Jay Radcliffe. Many of you perhaps know him or consider him a friend. Jay also happens to be a diabetic patient himself. So he's not just a hacker, he's also a consumer and a customer of these life-saving technologies. In the past year, Jay discovered a vulnerability in a medical device that he and other people rely on. But he didn't just do a, you know, razzling, dazzling demo at some event without letting the company know first. In fact, he coordinated with them, in this case, Johnson & Johnson, and helped them come out with an update to the software that runs this device, which is the device he found the vulnerability on. And this was part of a coordinated process that Jay was able to achieve because of the changes that have happened in the past 2 years in the relationships between hackers and regulators like the FDA, and most importantly, the companies that make these devices that we all trust. But unfortunately, not all stories are so great and end up nicely. In this case, the FDA said that this is the proactive behavior that they're looking for from the medical device manufacturer and research community, and this is the collaborative manner in which vulnerabilities can be addressed. So they're definitely encouraging this sort of activity. And I want to give a shout out to Suzanne Schwartz, who is a nice lady from the FDA that actually bothers to come out to hackers events. And I met her in Las Vegas, just at B-Sides, Security B-Sides, a few months ago, at a session dedicated to how hackers can collaborate with medical device manufacturers. I think that is great. And recently, the FDA also announced some guidelines on this, so there's a lot of great things happening. But there are also not-so-great stories. And these not-so-great stories can actually send us backwards and put so much fear into people that they will actually perhaps not even want to have a life changing or life-saving technology because of what they hear about in the news. What am I talking about? Talking about this story right here. Please let me know if you've heard about it here in the United States. A few months ago, a company called St. Jude Medical, maybe you've heard of them. They have big hospitals and they also manufacture medical devices. And apparently, in one of the devices that they make and the technology that that patients can use at home to connect with it, there were a few security issues. And these security issues were first discovered by a team of security researchers at a company called MedSec. But MedSec didn't actually notify St. Jude, or perhaps they did notify St. Jude, but it didn't get the response that they wanted. So they did something else. What they did is that they collaborated with a company called Muddy Waters that specializes in short selling. That means profiting from massive changes in the value of stock prices. And they told this investment company that they are going to come out with a public announcement about the vulnerabilities they found and that the stock is going to go down. And that's exactly what happened. Of course, St. Jude Medical decided this was totally not cool. And I have to say, I don't think it's super cool myself. And they decided to sue with legal action. Now, part of the defense for MedSec, and they have a few good things to say in their defense, including their positive motivations to force a change. Remember, demonstrate a threat, spark a solution, to do something that will cause the company to make a significant change, even if they're ignoring other notifications. One of the things MedSec did was actually hire a team of third-party security researchers to look at the claims. If they can show that what they found in the devices was actually really a security problem, and these are devices that are people's homes, then they're actually not defaming the name of this company. They're not wrongfully hurting their reputation, and they're not even acting on insider information, because these are consumer products that everybody could tinker with, at least theoretically. So recently I read an interview with the researchers that conducted this third-party evaluation. And definitely this is a story that brings up a very, very complicated nature of the relationships between hackers and companies right now. But let me kind of shorten up for you. Here's what the researcher had to say. The poor security decisions in the ecosystem that they looked at to explain them, he says, in order to protect your cat pictures on Facebook, they use encryption, which is 16 trillion, trillion times stronger than that by the one used to protect the communications between the implantable cardiac device and the Merlin at home, which is the device that patients can actually use to interact with their little pacemaker. So to put it in a little bit more simpler terms, to protect this, there is much more powerful encryption and authentication mechanisms in place than to protect this. Once again, if you didn't see the little switcheroo, this is safer than this. Does that make sense? I don't think that it does. However, I do want to point out that to expect a device like this to be able to have the CPU, the energy levels, and you know, the battery power to actually support higher encryption rates, more than 24-bit RSA, which is, I believe, what they actually used, there is a little bit of a problem there, because these are devices that are living inside people's bodies and have to work reliably for years. And they don't necessarily have the same power or CPU and same usage that we can expect from our phones or from our laptops. So it's not like this little device is going to run quantum computing right now. But I think they can do better than 24-bit RSA. RSA. Rivas, Shamir, and Adelman. Did you know when I got in the airport a few days ago, the immigration officer asked me, what is this RSA conference everybody's going to? Nobody can tell me what the RSA stands for. And I was like, of course, it's Rivas, Shamir, Adelman. It's the three guys that invented the algorithm. So this nice immigration officer, who's had a few tough weeks, I can imagine, he said, well, they should call it the three guys conference, and that's that. And kudos to him for the joke. I thought it was amusing as well. Recently, just a few weeks ago, in fact, 10 days ago, St. Jude released another advisory, this time with the CERT, the Computer Emergency Response Team, or the center here in the United States for ICS, for devices that are life-depending, such as medical technologies. So this story is far from being finished. The effect or the threat has been demonstrated, but the solution is still kind of, they're still working on it. So this is not the beautiful Cinderella story of Jay Radcliffe that I told you about before. It's a little bit more complicated. And I asked this woman what she felt about this. This is Professor Mary Moe. She is just an incredible security researcher from Norway. She also happens to have an implantable cardiac defibrillator in her body. In fact, what she has to say about it is that the day she had a cardiac arrest and ended up in the hospital unconscious, in fact, the surgeons and the medical team decided to give her an implantable device like this. They hadn't really asked her. So she realized that her heart is now potentially wired into a medical Internet of Things. This was done without her consent and without informing her of the different threats, problems, issues, risks. And maybe you're thinking, okay, this makes sense. If I'm on the table and I'm unconscious, they should just put some stuff into me, and then later on, when I'm awake and alive, explain the problems and the vulnerabilities. I guess that does make sense. However, it also highlights the issue that we are now becoming not just consumers of technology, we're living with these technologies in our bodies, and we're expected to be totally ignorant about the way their security works. It's supposed to be a black box to us, and we're expected to trust these. That's not so simple. So there is absolutely a tightrope balancing act when these companies create new technologies and when they interface with hackers and security researchers. How they respond to what a security researcher has to say makes a world of difference. If the folks at Johnson & Johnson had said to Jay, you know what, not interested, another email from a hacker, it could have ended very differently. If the folks at St. Jude Medical had maybe sat down for a conversation with MedSec, that story could have ended differently as well, and perhaps with less impact on their stock price. Tightrope balancing act, that's just our first act for the cyber circus today. Now these guys. I bet some of you know them. These are celebrity hackers, Chris Balasek and Charlie Miller. They are very known, especially at DEF CON and other security circles, for their hobby. Their hobby is hacking cars. And recently, they made a lot of headlines when they hacked this guy's car, because this is Andy Greenberg, a journalist from Wired, and they actually demonstrated to him how they can remotely, using a cellular connection, take over his vehicle. In fact, you can see Charlie in the back mirror there, remotely taking over his car and taking it off the road. If you haven't heard about this story yet, I'd be surprised, because here in the US, it's definitely made headlines. And the company that makes these cars, Jeep Chrysler, had to issue a recall of more than 1 million vehicles, if I'm not mistaken, in order to fix this potentially serious, critical, life-threatening vulnerability. How can they fix this problem? What was the solution for the recall of the vehicles? Any guesses? Yes, software update, indeed. A firmware update, in fact. You are more accurately correct. And for some people, they got a message to come into the garage. I believe some people actually got a thumb drive with the software that they were somehow supposed to install themselves. I have no idea how anything like that is expected to be done at people's garages. So people are now expected to be the CSOs and the IT managers of their pacemakers and their cars. And this is a story where I don't know if the demonstration caught Jeep Chrysler by surprise or not, but let's question the impact and the effect of it. There are still a few of these cars out on the road without a software update in them, because software updates for cars is a very complicated problem. One that is not, you know, we don't even have our laptops and mobile phones all up to date. I bet here at RSA you're hearing all about patch management and how difficult it is to update firmware. So how are people expected to do this for a bunch of different cars? Jeep Chrysler also perhaps has other vehicles that they make. Could there have been a better way to do this? Perhaps. This is another company, or this is another car. This is the Tesla flagship Model S. And in this case, it is actually presented to an audience of admiring hackers at DEF CON, the world's largest convention of hackers. How many of you have been to DEF CON this year or are planning to go? I would highly recommend that you put it on your schedule if you do want to know what's next and what's coming up. And more importantly, visit B-Sides, which is the community grassroots event right next to DEF CON. But in 2012, when Tesla brought their car to DEF CON, they didn't bring it for a test drive. They brought it to ask hackers, to actively encourage hackers to come and work with them as part of their security research and hacker outreach team, an active effort to get these people interested in hacking Teslas. And guess what? They succeeded. Here are at least two other hackers that maybe you haven't heard of, Mark Rogers and Kevin Mafferty, who were already, a couple of years after that, presenting demonstrations at DEF CON on how to hack a Tesla Model S. In this case, instead of journalists in the audience to show the world their stunning stunt, I believe they actually had people from Tesla in the room. And at some point, if I'm not mistaken, a guy from Tesla actually came up to stage and said, This is very cool. What's that?
From
the CTO. The CTO from Tesla was there, getting up on stage and saying, thank you guys for what you're doing. And that's not a coincidence. Of course, Tesla is a different company. They do everything differently. And it should also be noted that, for example, when they learn about a security problem in one of their cars, they actually do have the capability to push a button and make software updates deployed to almost all of the vehicles that are on the road, if not 100% of them. In fact, this year, a team of security researchers from China called Keren Security actually found a vulnerability with the way the firmware itself, the software that runs inside the car, is handled. And they figured out a way to replace it without the car rejecting this firmware. And they notified Tesla, and Tesla decided to introduce something to their cars, which you are pretty much, I'm sure, familiar with from your laptops. They decided to introduce digital certificate signing for any new software updates. So when you get a new patch or a new software, especially if you get one from Microsoft or another verified company, you also already expect to have it digitally signed. And your computer, your operating system, will tell you if it isn't. So this concept, very familiar to us, very old school, you could say, is now entering the automotive market. Tesla is perhaps the first company that's doing it. They're not going to be the last. In fact, I hope more and more people that make products that live inside people's homes, bodies, or garages will have similar mechanisms in place. Here's another cool thing that Tesla are doing pretty well and I like. These are challenge coins. So you might be familiar with challenge coins from other aspects of your life. But Tesla has these coins, these medals of honor, and they are awarded only to the top researchers. That means the top individual hackers around the world that contribute findings and let them know about problems. Now, they might not be worth $100,000 or headline in Wired or the big stage at DEF CON, but inside a community of motivated, curious security people, This is priceless. This is something that you cannot get in any other way. So they've already created this very clever way of engaging with people in a mechanism, in a way that really matters to them, that really makes these people tick. And some people also get hired by companies like Tesla after succeeding in their security research programs. And I'll talk more about that in a second. So what do you think? Taming some lions? I think that's pretty impressive. We can see that Tesla, at least, has taken a few lion-taming classes at Circus Academy 101. What else do we have today? Well, some people will talk to you about pacemaker hacks, or you'll hear in the news, oh, did you hear this new thing can be hacked? And there was a live demonstration at this hacker event. Most of the times, you won't really get the technical details. The media won't give them to you because they prefer the highlights, and you won't be able to even understand exactly what happened. Sometimes you do get a lot of technical details. So with Chris and Charlie, for example, when they hacked the Jeep, there was a lot of very solid technical work and details that you could review and learn from. And they've been doing that for a few years. I've been following their work. They always release notes and actually make their data accessible. A lot of people will tell you that these hacks are actually sometimes counterproductive, because they scare people so much, and they actually cause companies, perhaps like car companies and medical device companies, to walk away from the table instead of wanting to stay and have a conversation. They are extremely polarizing. So either you like them and enjoy watching them, or you think they're dangerous and reckless. Anyway, you can't stay neutral. You can't stay passive, and neither does the media. And so that's why I think it's important that we talk about these stunt hacks and that we also talk about their impact and how much of a difference can they make. Can they demonstrate the threat to spark a solution? This is the question I'd like to ask. I also think that public opinion matters a lot. All of you here are probably really familiar with that conversation that you have talking to somebody who says, so what do you do? And you say, oh, I'm in cybersecurity. And maybe 5 years ago, 10 years ago, that person would be like, oh, okay. That's something geeky and nerdy that doesn't matter to me and I don't know about. Now, all of a sudden, people are like, oh, so is my phone safe? Did the Russians hack the government? Can printers take over the world? What's going on? Who's saving us? So public opinion of security issues really matters. And apparently, these stunt hacks can get into people's minds more than a lot of other things, more than the talks that happen here at RSA or DEF CON, which are inside our ecosystem. So they absolutely do matter. And sometimes they are highlighting universal issues. A lot of the examples I've spoken to you about today included things like radio connectivity or cellular connectivity, firmware issues, authentication, encryption. These are not totally new issues for the security industry. They're just happening in a totally new way in the world. And we are kind of getting a glimpse of it, I think, due and in fact in thanks to a lot of these demonstrations. So, It's a bonus reason to start noticing and caring and discussing these stunt hacks because they do give us a little bit of a glimpse to what hackers care about and what they find engaging to mess around with, and that really matters for us. As we connect more and more things, of course, I would like to give you some ideas of how you can find some of these new connected devices. I'm sure you've heard about IoT all the time. Is anyone here not familiar with Shodan? Okay, everybody knows Shodan? You don't know Shodan? Great. Okay, a few people. So, three people, that's already great, because Shodan is a search engine for connected internet devices. And you can look it up, shodan.io, and it's actually a very powerful tool for discovering devices that are not supposed to be connected to the internet, but are. And it can be used by good guys and bad guys, of course. And a couple of years ago, a team of security researchers from Israel, actually used Shodan to identify a network of webcams in their own backyard that were hacked, that were actually infected with malware, and were operating as part of a botnet. Now, it's important to understand that the people who hacked these web cameras were not interested in their secrets. They were not interested in what was happening in those people's backyards. They were interested in these cameras as assets. Computers or micro-controlled computers connected in a broadband environment that they can use to hack other people. Now, a couple years ago when the guys from Encapsular released this report, it made some headlines, but it didn't make nearly as many headlines as something that happened just 2 months ago. And this is the Google Trends report from around October 23rd, 2016. with this massive rise in the global interest in what Internet of Things hacking means. Any guesses why? Mirai, that is correct. October, probably the Black Friday of October 2016, and not a good kind of Black Friday, when the Mirai botnet, a network of infected devices, people's webcams, routers, and other home devices, was actually used to power, supercharge, a denial of service attack that took down websites that we all know and love and trust, like PayPal and Spotify, and the entire network of a French ISP, and a lot of other places around the world. So all of a sudden, people care about these hacked devices, because they can hack other people's computers, which means Spotify is broken. So that gets people to care. But I want to say a few things about Mirai. I'm sure you've all read about Mirai, and you've heard about it from Brian Krebs, who is probably both the leading expert and perhaps the cause for Mirai, which is a pretty unique position to be in. But he did this very interesting post, a specific one about Mirai, talking about who makes the devices that were actually hacked. And what is it about these devices that made them so easily hackable? So there's a bunch of usernames and passwords up there. I know it's very hard to see, so let me make it easier for you guys. Here's one of the most popular username and password combinations that were used in the Mirai attack. This is for a popular brand of webcams. Here's another one that I particularly liked, and my personal favorite. So these are the types of hard-coded passwords that the people who make the devices, not the customers, not the people who bought them and set them up in their homes, not the guys at Best Buy or the Geek Squad, but the companies that actually make and manufacture these devices, these are the types of passwords that they had in mind. And some of the big names behind these three username and password combinations are huge companies that make huge, huge. I just realized I sound a little bit like this president. So these are very big companies that make technologies that we all use, and they are trusted names. In fact, some of the companies that make these technologies are even out here on the expo floor. Shame on them. So Mirai had a few interesting aspects to it that really made everybody care. One is that it was this perfect storm. It was a combination of denial of service attacks done for money or, you know, reputational gain. And the Mirai story is very complicated. I won't get into the reasons and the motivations and who is behind that. You can read Brian Krebs's very detailed reporting on that. But denial of service attacks we've already seen. This time, they were also supercharged by using attacks on basic internet protocols like NTP and DNS, which we all rely on, are not managed by any single individual or organization, are actually part of our ecosystem, and can be utilized for malicious purposes by devices, even not so smart devices, even dumber devices like some of these webcams. And finally, they utilize the very easy default username and password issue. And it's important to note this was not done manually. Mirai is an automated botnet. It's also a worm. That means it crawls around the world automatically looking for devices with these types of usernames and passwords. And I'll show you an example in a second. But this was definitely a wake-up moment for a lot of people outside of the security industry. In fact, here's an example of a demo of a toaster, a web-enabled toaster with a login root, and the password wasn't actually root the first time, but I think the second time it was. So this is basically a demo that a few people created to see how fast would a web toaster get hacked with a simple username and password combination by one of these automated worms. What's really interesting is that this was actually created by The Atlantic, and they discovered that within 1 hour, they started getting hacked automatically. Now, The Atlantic, in case you don't know it, is a great publication, but I wouldn't say they're Wired or, you know, Gizmodo. This is like classical, mainstream, conservative, perhaps, or liberal, I don't know, but very, very established media that's starting to really care about security issues. So Mirai did for IoT security awareness what all of the other stunt hacks and demos and reports never did. Maybe there is even a silver lining to Mirai. It's a question mark right there. If you want to read the report, The Atlantic's website has it. I mentioned an elephant in the room. We cannot let you go without the elephant. And I mentioned this elephant. It was here with us in the room. In fact, there's a few elephants in the front row. I'm looking at you, Seth. Yes, and that's not a judgment, I'm sorry. But the elephant in the room that was with us the whole talk is actually the media. The media are as an important player for the security ecosystem perhaps even more than some of the companies and some of the security researchers. It brings stories up, it puts things in people's minds, it sometimes shares fake news or alternative facts, and now, more than ever, it really matters what the media has to say about cybersecurity. The reason I pointed Seth, of all people, is because, first of all, he's a friend, so I know, even though he's in the front row, I can pick on him. Thank you, Seth. But second of all, because he is a celebrated journalist and an important member of the media reporting about issues. And I know that he usually gets it right, but not all journalists always get it right. Yeah, thank you. Now, especially when stories are out there that catch people's attention, like an attack on a Barbie doll can help people spy on your kids. And why would you even need an IoT-enabled Barbie? I mean, I like a toy you can program as much as the next girl, but I really don't understand the functionality of this. Maybe it is to get more ladies into, or more young women into IoT, and that's cool, but not if it can be a threat to their privacy or to their safety. What about baby monitors? I'm sure you've heard about these in the news. Now, I question whether the variety of different baby monitors out there on the market is actually as susceptible and as potentially vulnerable to attacks as the media would like us to believe. I also like to say that while this could potentially be a threat to your privacy or even to your home safety, I don't consider this as huge, perhaps an issue, as attacks on critical infrastructure. And I don't just bring up critical infrastructure by chance. Of course, I'm sure this year, definitely here at RSA, you heard that the power cuts in the Ukraine and the Crimea that recently happened have already been verified by independent news caused by cyber attacks. So the media definitely would like to tell you about this in different ways. A conservative way, like the BBC, less conservative way, it could happen here. Fear-mongering, and that's what bugs me a little bit. I like Vice, but I think, yes, it is an important lesson for us to learn from what's happening in the Ukraine, but it's also important to explain that in the US, the electrical system and the way that it works is totally different than in other places in the world. But it could happen here. So prepare your shelters, join the Amish, and don't forget to stock up the water. Now, just last week, a blackout in Brussels took out the power and the electricity. Media is posting videos of sirens. Is it a cyber terrorist attack? Is it a classical terrorist attack? Who knows? Well, the electricity company knows, and they put out a tweet. They actually had to, you know, ensure the public that it's just a malfunction and it wasn't the cause of a terrorist attack or a cyber attack. People still didn't have power, so I mean, it is a little bit reassuring, but the company was still out of power. So the problem actually happened, but people care more about it if it's done by a few hackers in another country than if, you know, it happens because a squirrel ate the power lines. And we all know that's a real problem. So, yes, it is a real problem, Seth. Cyber Squirrel 1, check it out. It's an issue. So how are we feeling about the circus? We're terrified, we're entertained, we don't know what to do. Don't worry, I won't send you home without a few drops of sunshine, ideas of what you can do. First of all, stop the spread of FUD. What is the FUD? Fear, uncertainty, and doubt. And it's actually the bread and butter of a lot of the security industry and even events like this. Even sometimes videos that show up before your talk, perhaps. Not naming names or anything, just theoretically. When you hear about fuddy sounding things, question it, get to the facts, and then when you get the facts, tell people about it. When somebody talks to you, for example, and says, oh, a country could start cyber war in a push of a button, what I would like from you to do as a responsible security professional and somebody that cares about hope more than fear is to say, well, yeah, let's hold our horses. Here's what's happened, here's what's possible, here's what might happen, here's what we're gonna do about it, which is the most important aspect. That's what I think. So stop the spread of FUD, it's in your hands. And in fact, there's a few more lessons we can learn from the stories today. Trust and safety might be our new goal as an industry, not just our secrets. It's not credit card numbers or the people we meet on Facebook or our private, most intimate wishes. Yes, those are important too, but perhaps life-threatening things, safety things, and trustworthy devices that will power our modern way of life should come first. A suggestion. Secondly, bugs, security disclosures, and stunts will happen. But how a company, how an organization deals with them will matter even more. How you respond to it and how you then fix the problem, that's what will define the future of how secure that company will be. And the media and the public opinion makes a huge difference, not just on how afraid people are, but also on policy, on budgets, on decisions that governments can make. So when you see people starting to spread false information or FUD or just a media story getting out of hand, you can stop it. It's actually in your hands. And you have more than that in your hands. Remember what we said earlier? You're actually a CSO of your own home, of your car, of the devices that you bring into your house, the things that you maybe recommend your family and friends to buy. Even if you don't run the network at your organization, you have the capacity to have safer products at home. And you can do that by actually demanding safer products from the companies that make them, by changing default usernames and passwords, for example, by having more secure Wi-Fi. There's a lot of things that you can do. You have to start thinking of yourself as the CSO of your own little family, your home, your own community. The phones, the laptops that are in your house actually depend on you. All of these devices can be hacked, but good news. We can secure all the things. Or perhaps there is the potential to do that. One great thing that happened the past year is that the FTC, so the Federal Trade Commission, actually has a competition now for security researchers and hackers to find ways to secure devices. Specifically, they're focusing on the problem of how do you push out software updates once a vulnerability has been found. So I think that competition-based innovation, which is what they're doing with this little thing here, could actually create immense value. It's a great approach. I Am the Cavalry is some very good news. I Am the Cavalry is a movement of hacktivists and hackers and security researchers I'm proud to say I'm a member of. And this is a group of people really dedicating security research to be focused on things that matter for human lives and public safety. Homes, cars, medical devices specifically, and infrastructure. In fact, I Am the Cavalry even worked with Jay Radcliffe and Mary Mo and the FDA to create something, the Hippocratic Oath for Connected Medical Devices. A set of guidelines, voluntary guidelines, that can encourage both medical device companies, health practitioners, and regulators to figure out these really complicated security issues that are gonna be living inside our bodies pretty soon. So that's cool, that's some hope right there. I know I said bugs will happen. One thing I mentioned throughout this talk is how companies can interact with hackers in the form of bug bounty programs. Now, in this point in time, 2017, I expect you have all to have heard about bug bounty programs because the past year, 2016, is the year they really went mainstream. But nonetheless, just a brief moment to say that bug bounty programs allow companies as big and as important as Western Union or United Airlines or car companies or Facebook or Google or Microsoft to actually use that immune system of hackers around the world by encouraging them to submit bugs, to find vulnerability issues, and then rewarding them for what they are finding. If you want to learn more about bug bounty programs, why they matter, how they can perhaps be a good idea for your company, your country, or your organization, this is the woman you should be looking at, Katie Masuris, a trailblazer and pioneer for bug bounties who got Microsoft to have an active bug bounty program in place. And she's also one of the women behind the ISO, the International Standard for Vulnerability Disclosure. So if your company digs ISOs, and I know some people do, this is actually a free standard. So you can get this ISO for free and implement it at your company. And that's really a good step to start with. Katie was also one of the women behind Hack the Pentagon. So if the DOD, one of the most established icons of conservative power here in the US, has a bug bounty program in place to collaborate with hackers, I'm pretty sure other companies and organizations and countries can take a lesson or two. Finally, one final note. We need more hackers, friendly ones, and hackers in different shapes, colors, sizes, and from all walks of life. And that's why I invited a special lady here with me here into the room. I do have my sister, and you're very special to me, but I am referring to this lady, Tara. Tara, the woman in the black hat, is a poker player, entrepreneur, and an author of a book, which I helped write. Now, a few years ago, Tara wanted to get more people into the industry, but this is pretty much all that was out there. And that's not a great reference, especially if you have a younger sister or another friend or relative or colleague that you want to have brought into, introduced into this industry. So Tara reached out to me and to seven other fantastic women to write this fantastic book, Women in Tech, and we will be signing copies at the RSA bookstore today at 4. So please join us there, and one of you lucky people who has moved to the front will actually get one as well, courtesy of me. So to wrap things up, not just circus, entertainment, and prizes, sunshine and things you can do. Demand trustworthy devices from people who sell them to you and people that develop them. Fight fear with facts. Collaborate with hackers, perhaps the most important part, at least from my perspective. And if that's not enough sunshine for you, you are very much invited to Tel Aviv, where Cyber Week takes place every year in June. And it's a free conference, it's international, and we do also host B-Sides Tel Aviv as part of that. And the weather is guaranteed to be sunny or your money back. Did I mention it's a free conference? All right, I hope to see you in Tel Aviv. Thank you very much.